Hey, everybody. Welcome back to New Life Online, and it's outstanding to be in worship with you today. I pray that you have been blessed, that praise and worship just stirred your spirit, and let me just say how thankful again that I am for all of our volunteers, our band, our musicians, all of those behind the scenes who make this thing happen. And how they just lead us straight into the presence of God. And man, I'm just so grateful to be a part of New Life and the fantastic things that God is doing in and through New Life. And I'm glad that you're a part of New Life. And if you are guests with us today online, we say welcome. And maybe you're just New Life today, but we consider you ours. If you're here, we have no visitors, not even online. We have guests because we're prepared for you, and we believe that you are right where the Holy Spirit wanted you to be. So welcome. Let me also say that you have an opportunity to give and support New Life through stewardship, through your worship and tithing, and also through offerings. And you can just click on that link that's in the comments or in the description and go right to our PayPal portal. Just one click, and it'll take you right to it. And also, you can mail that in if you've been doing that. For those of you who are doing that, just continue to do so. It's working out just fine. Just continue to be faithful to what God is doing. God is being faithful to you. Be faithful to Him, and continue to support ministry. And don't forget, when you're giving to New Life, you're really giving through New Life. And just this week, we've been able to help more families and be able to do some things that we've been needing to do. And so let me say again, thank you for your faithfulness. Now let's get into the Word of God today. And we are going to continue in this series, Not Just Words. This is week 5. And today's title of the message is called Love. Love. We've looked at bread, water, breath. Last week we looked at dominion, and what I thought was a fantastic word. I just enjoyed preaching that word, and many of you have reached out to me and said that you were really inspired and that it really ministered to you. And some of you said, I'm going to have to watch that again and maybe watch it a couple of times and just to get down to it. Today we're going to see more of the same, and next week we're going to look at this message called Symbols. So some of these hidden gems and things that we're talking about, we're going to see more of them today and then next week for sure. Following that, Pastor Lori is going to be bringing a powerful message to you called Sight, and then we'll move ahead. We have actually a few more weeks in this series, but today we're going to be talking about love, and as we continue, I want to remind you the reason that we're doing this series. This series is about the Bible. In this series, we are taking an in-depth look at the Word of God, and let me remind you that the Bible is the Word of God. Many don't believe that. And they say they're just words. But this is not just a word. This is not just another book. This is the Word. Can somebody say amen to that? In our very first message, I told you that there is an aggressive movement in our culture to not only get rid of church and the influence of church, and it's there, and if you don't believe it's there, it's there. But also, there's an aggressive movement to discredit, diminish, and reduce the impact of the Word of God. And people would love for you to look at it as nothing more than just some work of literary accomplishment, or just a book. Even those who profess to be followers of Christ are attacking the Word of God and how it works all in all. So let me remind you again that the Bible is not just a book, it is the book. It's not just a word, it is the Word. And the Bible is not just good for doctrine. It's not just good for, you know, theology. The Bible says it is good for doctrine, it is good for theology, it's good for reproof, it's good for correction, it's good for helping you in every good work in this life. The Word of God is what you need because it's God's Word revealed to us. Why we've been looking each week at the different aspects is so you can see exactly what the Bible is. So you can see who God is revealed in His Word and why it's so amazing and important to us, so that we can not only understand the Word but realize that we need the Word. And I hope that through this series so far that you have gained not only a deeper knowledge and understanding of the Word, but you've gained a deeper hunger for the Word. And do you want to spend more time reading the Word and listening to the Word and having the Holy Spirit reveal the Word to you? And He is the one that leads us into all truth. And we must remember that this is a spiritual book written by a spiritual being, written to spiritual beings. The more you understand this Word, the more you take this Word in, the more you listen and learn and live this Word, the more you will fall in love with this Word, and the more life you will live in it, through it, and from it. Because I'm telling you, you will experience more victory, you will experience more peace, you will experience more joy, you will experience more fullness in your journey with Christ, and you will be able to share with those in your life the things that you are experiencing. It all comes from the Word. And I want you to desire the Word actually more than your very breath. I tell you, what I really hope is that you would find in you what the prophet said, that it's fire shut up in your bones and it can't be quenched, that you burn with a passion and a hunger for God and His Word. That's why we've been doing it. So, today we're going to continue and we're going to be looking at the subject of love. But I want us to not just look at certain parts of the Bible or the topic love. I want us to look at the Bible overall, the whole Bible, as the love story of the Word of God. And we're going to see three huge things that individually are still amazing, but when you put them all together, you will understand and realize that these three things spell out to us God's love story. If we're not careful, here's the thing. We will miss the small stories, the little parts, the small things, the hidden gems that make up the greater story of the total Word of God. A lot of times we talk about love, we pull out one section of Scripture, John 3:16, or we pull out, you know, 1 Corinthians 13, and we say love here, love there, and we only focus on certain aspects. And today, what I want to do is focus on the overall theme of the Word of God, and that is this, that this Word is God's love story to us. And I need you to do something for me today. Because we're going to look at three things, three elements that are commonly part of this love story, that are common to this love story, I should say. And I need you to do something very important for me. We're going to look at the exile, the blood sacrifice, and the mission. Those will be our three main topics that we look at today. And when we talk about these things, now I realize that these are Old Testament, these are mostly Old Testament terminologies and terms. And I'll show you this as we continue on why I chose those words. But it's tempting to us when we talk about the exile, the blood sacrifice, and the mission to equate it all to thinking that we're talking about salvation. We believers tend to focus a lot on salvation, and I get it, and I understand why. But in order for us to get all that we're supposed to see from this message today, I need you to not focus on salvation. And I know this will be hard to do, and I'm already I can already hear my phone buzzing. I mean, I really can tell that that's getting in your craw just a little bit. I'm not trying to minimize or try to take away from the importance of salvation, not at all. But many times, in fact, most of the time, when we read certain passages and the things we're going to be talking about in Scripture today, we're going to be looking at different aspects of them, but we immediately think about salvation. And I want us to see that these things are not only about salvation, but they have a lot to do with our life and our calling on earth, not just our waiting to get to heaven. Not that heaven is on earth, but a part of our calling is to bring heaven to earth. I want you to think about how Jesus taught us to pray. When the disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray, they said, we want to learn how to pray, God. Show us. So Jesus said, when you pray, pray like this. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And there's a powerful, powerful truth that we see in that. And so we're going to look at what these things mean. And at the end of this message, there's going to be a call to action that we as believers and we as the body of Christ and we as a church need to answer. So I need you, I'm going to say this again, I need you to separate this concurrent theme that is all the way through the Bible, even though we're just, you know, going to mention it a little bit, blood sacrifice, exile, we're looking at all these things, I need you to separate those from the death and resurrection of Jesus. We're going to talk about the death and resurrection of Jesus, but we're not going to talk about in the same context that we normally do, and that is only in salvation. So I've probably got you a little messed up already. So just stay with me, okay? Stay with me and let's catch the greater these things that God wants us to see. So help me out. Is that all right? Do like this. Even if you don't understand what I'm talking about, just help me out. So let's look at the first phase of this love story, and that is the exile. Now, the exile is something that all of us go through, and most of us immediately think about the Israelites and Moses when talking about the exile, but there was an exile that happened long before that. We see it in Genesis chapter 3, verses 23 and 24, and it says this, therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden and to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree, to keep the way of the tree of life. And so that was the first exile. God sent them out of the garden. And if you think about it, we're in the mode of that constantly today at some point. In our lives, we are constantly back and forth in exile. The truth is, we want to get back to the garden. If we can just get back to the garden, if we can just get back to the perfection of the garden, to the peace of the garden, to the security of the garden, and yes, salvation is the answer to spiritual exile that happened in that fall, and we do need a Savior. But exile is a part of our lives in many ways all the time. Sometimes, every day. Exile is actually a constant in our lives. The first exile was not just a fall, but I want you to look at me and understand this. It was not just a fall. It was a separation. An exile for the purpose the point of this message, and for our understanding, is defined as a separation from God's purpose in your life. A separation from God's purpose in your life. So remember, keep this separated from salvation and get what the Spirit is saying in this. So there are many times when we are in exile, when we are separated from what God has called us to do and to be in our lives. This is to be living in exile. The children of Israel were in exile when they were living in bondage to the Egyptians. Jonah was in exile when he was in the belly of the fish for 3 days. The people who were building the Tower of Babel experienced exile when God separated them and gave them different languages. Joseph was in exile when his brothers sold him into slavery and faked his death. David was in exile when he was hiding from Saul. And even Jesus himself, if you understand what I'm saying, was in a form of exile when feeling the weight of sin and the world upon him as he hung upon the cross as he felt the separation from his Father when he cried out from the 22nd Psalm, my God, why have you forsaken me? Even when Jesus was in the wilderness and he was fasted 40 days and night, it was a form of a purposeful exile. Think about it. He was baptized in water, and then the Holy Ghost descended upon him. He was baptized in the Spirit, and immediately our normal thought process is, now time to go to work. But the Bible says that the Spirit of God drove him into the wilderness, and he stayed there 40 days. And I want you to see something. I'll show you this more next week. The devil didn't just come to him at the very end and say, oh, by the way, before you leave, I'm going to tempt you. He was actually there the whole time. Not just him. He had a lot of company with him trying to fight and defeat Satan, or Jesus. Satan was trying to do that. But this was a separation to bring about God's purpose. Now, that's a different kind of thing. But I did want to mention to you so you can see what I understand and see what I'm talking about and understand when I say exile. Now, all of these exiles, all of these were exiles, but what's most important for us is to be able to recognize when we're in exile. If we aren't in exile, then we don't have a need to be pulled back into God's purpose. Now, we can be in exile and not recognize that we're in exile. So, in essence, in our understanding, we're really not in exile even though we are. Does that make sense? Remember that I often say the only thing worse than being lost is being lost and not knowing that you're lost. So we need to recognize when we are in exile. When we are outside of God's will and purpose for us, when we are outside of God's influence, when we are outside of God's presence, when we are outside of walking with the power and the Spirit of God in our lives. And there really is a ton that we can talk about here. But what I want to do in just these few moments, we won't go into all that. But what I really want you to understand is that when we are in exile, we are lost. We are needing help. We are needing to be saved. Remember, not salvation, but saved from exile. Do you know you can be saved and still be lost? That's what we're talking about. And we go in and out of this exile many times in our lives, and the Spirit of God wants to keep us in line with His will and His purpose. You say, well, I thought this had to do with God's love story. It does. Stay with me. So look, if we look specifically at the case of the Israelites and their exile and what brought them out of exile, the Passover, the blood of the sacrifice was placed on the doorpost that brought about their freedom. They celebrated what God did in the Passover, but it wasn't just to celebrate that God saved them. What they celebrated was to remember what brought them out of exile. So the next thing we need to look at is the blood sacrifice. And this is all one story, so stay with me. So I realize that this is an Old Testament term, blood sacrifice, that was used for the remission and forgiveness of sins. And we want to get all the details of the sacrifice. We want to get into every bit of it. But if we just look specifically at the case of Passover and what I'm talking about right now in this message, the primary focus of this Passover was not the forgiveness of sins. Even though it is immediately connected to it, the way that Passover foretells the crucifixion and is a picture of Christ's sacrifice for the remission of our sins is definitely there. There's no question about that. But there's another element that we need to see. The Passover feast was designed to be a celebration of remembrance about how they had been taken out of bondage, out of exile, and set free to live their lives now through God because of what He did for them then. Okay? So, to make the connection of where we're looking at, I want you to understand some things. They were set free to live their lives no longer as slaves in bondage, but to live for God in that moment. And that's why they celebrated that Passover, to celebrate that freedom every year. And Jesus' death and resurrection coincides with the Passover feast. Here's what 1 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm going to look at the last part of verse 7 and verse 8. It says, "For indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." So the death and resurrection of Jesus are intimately connected to the Passover. And what it teaches us is that through the death and resurrection of Christ, we have been set free out of bondage, out of slavery, set free to live the life in Christ. Now, typically what we talk about is salvation. We've been redeemed. We've been saved. Our names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And so again, I know I keep saying this, but I want you to understand I'm not discounting that. That is a given. I'm talking about how we live. That's the reason we're still here on this earth. Remember that if it was the only reason that Jesus came and died was for salvation and for heaven, then why didn't it all end right then? Why didn't it all just stop? Everything. Why instead of ending, why did Jesus give us things like the Great Commission, the Sermon on the Mount, the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit? These were all given to us to live our lives here on this earth. And until we go to be with Him forever, that is what we are supposed to do. The Bible says, "Occupy until I come." In other words, stay busy, stay here, keep doing what I called you to do. So it is intimately connected with Passover, but it's also connected with creation. Let me show you this, and I want you to look at it. In a minute, we're going to take a look at some things from John chapter 19 and 20. And we won't look at all of it. We won't actually even read it. Just talk about some of these things that we see. And we looked at a lot of that last week. So if you want to make a note and go back and read the whole thing in context, John 19 and 20, you go ahead and do that. But I want us to look at the connection of our lives and Passover and Christ and His resurrection and His death, outside of the fact that we are amazingly, wonderfully, incredibly, miraculously saved and redeemed. But I want to look at some things that we see that coincide with our lives. And we're going to take a look at some really not just cool symbols, but some amazing things that we see that correlate through the Word of God and what they teach us about our lives today. So here we go. What we see in John chapter 19 is that this was the sixth day of the week, and Jesus was presented to the crowd by Pilate on the sixth day. Before I say that, let me show you this. In John chapter 1, in the very first verse of John chapter 1, John says, "In the beginning." He actually pays homage to the creation. I told you it was connected to creation. It is, and we're going to see more things about it. But also, Genesis chapter 1, the very first thing that the Bible says about creation is this: "In the beginning." You see that? Now look at 19 again. The sixth day of the week is the day that Pilate presented Jesus to the crowd, and he makes this statement: "Here is the man." He presents him to everybody. And it was on the sixth day of creation when God created man in his image. So, if you look at it like this, it was the sixth day of the week when God put His image into man, and on the sixth day of the week during the crucifixion narrative, Jesus stands before the crowd as fully man, but also as the full image of God. At the end of the sixth day, in Genesis chapter 2, the Bible tells us that God ended his work. And basically he says, it's finished. At the end of the sixth day, in the crucifixion story, when Jesus was hanging from the cross, what does he say? It is finished. The correlation of these two is really, really powerful to see. In the creation account, the Bible says on the seventh day, God rested. And we remember on the seventh day of the crucifixion account, we know that Jesus was in the tomb. He was busy in the spirit world, but his body on the seventh day was laid to rest. And then we see the first day of the week following creation. It was the first day of a new creation. Do you see that? God took 6 days to build everything. To build is not the right word, but you know what I'm saying. He spoke and created everything in 6 days. Then he rested on the seventh. And so the next day, the first day of the new week, was the first day in a new creation. Stay with me. And it was that first day of the week following the crucifixion that Mary Magdalene comes to the tomb and finds it empty. And we talked about last week what happened on that first day of the week. And it resulted in what we can now shout in a victorious declaration from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. First day of the week following creation, new creation. First day of the week following resurrection, new creation. See, we long so desperately to get back to that perfect place, to get back to that garden, to get back to the place of relationship and the presence and walking with God and being in communion. And that's what Jesus brought for us. And now as we look last week at one of the possible meanings of Mary's encounter with Jesus, remember when we talked about the gardener? I want you to see it from this viewpoint as well. We long to get back to the garden. Jesus reestablished the relationship that was lost at the garden. And what did Mary think she saw when she first laid eyes on Jesus? The gardener. And I know that may not be the actual meaning of her thinking, but we can see an illustration that when Jesus defeated Satan and destroyed sin, conquering death and the grave, and he took back the dominion that was lost, he says to us all in that resurrection act and what he did on that day of atonement and reconciliation once and for all, he says, I've got the keys to the garden. I took it all back. You can walk with God again. Here are the keys to the kingdom. Now go and do what Adam couldn't finish. Go do what I created you to do. Establish the kingdom. Can you see that? Powerful, powerful truth and reality. Now we still have to deal with the consequences of the fall. But God owns this place. And his dominion is our dominion. And we are in him once again. There are things we can't control. But what we can do is what he taught us to pray in Matthew 6:10, and I told you about it just a few minutes ago. What we can do with this kingdom authority, with this kingdom keys, with this kingdom dominion, with this kingdom power that he brought back and gave to us is live our lives by being able to say, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We are kingdom people with a kingdom authority and a kingdom mandate from the authority of the kingdom. Think about that. Which brings me to the last thing, which is the mission. Jesus saved us from our sins and set us into a mission that he called us to do even before he saved us. Ephesians chapter 2 verses 8 through 10 says this. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, watch this, for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now, I won't read the scripture, but Jesus told us in Luke chapter 10, verse 27, that the mission comes down really to two things. Love God and love others. Now remember, we're talking about love. I told you that the Bible is God's love story, and here is the meat of it all. You got so caught up so far with probably not connecting this with salvation, and we're talking about living, and we're talking about power again, and we're talking about, you know, living out what God did in us, and we are talking about all those things, but this is how God shows his love. This is the love story of the Bible. Follow me in this. God loves us. Before we know him, he loves us. Then he loves us through others. Before we know him, he loves us through others. And then we know him. Then we come to know him, and we love him as he loves us. Now follow this. Then he loves others through us. Before they even know him. And then as we show our love, they realize our love is not our love only, but it's his love. And then they get to love him because they begin to trust him and they experience his love. And see, it's all about living out this thing. It's not just about being saved. You understand what I'm talking about now? This amazing, powerful love story. So that is the mission, love. But how is that love supposed to be lived out? Because it isn't just enough to know the mission. We need to live the mission. And so there's a verse of scripture in the Bible that most of us are familiar with. And I want us to look at this verse and see exactly what Jesus is telling us in this passage. Now, Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit. And many times I've skipped right over these meanings when I'm only talking about, like, what's the purpose of the Holy Spirit. I actually have a set of lessons called The Office and Work of the Holy Spirit. And I talk about why the Holy Spirit came, who he is, what he does, what we do through him, how he empowers us. And I've taught this verse many, 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 many times, and I never saw these truths in here. But this teaches us how we are supposed to live out this love story in this world. You ready? Here's what it says, John chapter 16, verses 8 through 10. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin. Now, some translations say he will prove the world wrong. He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness, which also means justice, and of judgment. Verse 9. Of sin, because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness or justice, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. And of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. Now, I want us to look at each one of these, and I want us to see some things about this. Let's look at the first one, sin. He's not saying here that we will not sin, or that we won't struggle with temptation to sin, or that we will be some holier than thou, better than the sinners, and they're going to be convicted, but we're saved, and so we don't have to worry about all that stuff anymore, and we look down our noses at people. That's not what he's saying at all. But what God is saying is that they have sinned because they have not believed that he is God. They sin because they don't yet believe. Do you see that? So our role in this love story and in this purpose is to live a life with power, fruit, and the help of the Holy Spirit that displays and helps unbelievers to know that there is a God and that the life in him is amazing. Our witness is to live how we live in the Spirit in a way that they see a fantastic alternative to the chaos, death, and destruction of the sin that rules their life at this moment. Let's look at righteousness, of justice. It says, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Now, this not only proves the righteousness of God and the power of Jesus overcoming it all, but it also gives us a mandate in the righteousness and justice of God. And let me show you what that is. We are called to do justice. That's what the Bible tells us. Not to talk about justice, not to demand justice, not to cry out for justice, not to point out injustice. We are called to do justice. This means to do for those who need justice. The widow, the orphan, the poor, the lost, the hurting, the weak, the disenfranchised. Those who need us to step in the power of God and bring about righteousness and justice. And we can certainly relate this to how and what we are seeing in our lives right now as people are trying to battle in the realm of social justice. And think about this. The primary way that it's done in our society is by protest. And we've done that in the past. And it's happening now and probably will happen more in the future. The problem is that when we protest against the things that we are protesting against, people begin to look at us and look at our lives. And if our lives are falling apart, or we're part of things that are not proper or right, who's going to listen to people say we need justice when we aren't living justice? Now, I'm not specifically talking about the current issues in our nation, but let's just examine them for a second. I'm not trying to be political. I'm trying to make a point, so stay with me here on the point of justice. What's the main thing that's causing problems and causing people to not really focus on what the protest is supposed to be in our world right now? The chaos, the destruction, the violence, the anarchy that's coming out of all of it. Listen, there is a real issue that many people want to focus on, but it's lost its voice. Now, we talked about that for several weeks a little while back, and I'm telling you, we need to stand up for right. We need to stand up for justice. We need to stand up for things that are not right in the law and in justice and in righteousness. But listen, we lose our influence if the focus is not on the justice. This current cause has lost its voice. Now, there's a strong voice. There's a strong focus and influence. But sadly, it's not the focus and influence that it's supposed to be. And even when it is, people can't focus away from the problem so much that they conflate the two. And they see somebody doing something that really is standing up for the issue, and they immediately conflate it with the problem. Are you following me? The injustice that is happening, supposedly in the name of justice, has torn down the influence of what we want to try to do to bring about justice. See, the Bible doesn't call believers to talk about justice. The Bible doesn't call believers to demand justice or identify injustice or point to something and say, that needs to change. I'll say it again. The Bible calls us to do justice. Belief is your salvation. But doing the work of God is your witness. And what we do matters. And I know that we're living in a world and our media is showing things and we're saying that the means justifies the ends and what they do doesn't really matter because the issue is too important. But I'm telling you, you don't see that playing out in practicality because the fact of the matter is what we do matters. It is not what we say about things in the practical life. Now, I'm not talking about the authority and speaking the word of God here right now. I'm talking about living practical lives. It doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter what you promise. It doesn't matter what you think you're going to do or give. It doesn't matter what you have the potential to do or give or what can come from what you want to do. It matters what you do. We are called to do justice. And then there's judgment. And what Jesus is saying is that when he took back the keys and dominion, Satan was judged. Now remember, I showed you last week that a judgment took place during that time. And so Jesus says to the ruler of this world, he says, or basically what he says, not to the ruler, but he says to us, the ruler of this world is judged. He's telling us, I have judged him, I have found him guilty, I have conquered him and his work, I have overcome him and this grave and this world, and I have sentenced him. Somebody ought to be shouting, praise the Lord, right there. So what we need to see is that we don't need to judge, because he has judged and the Holy Spirit will bring conviction, so it's not our world to play judge or Holy Ghost. It's not our job. We're called to be witnesses in this great trial, not a judge. It's not our place to judge and to pass judgment or place judgment in the lives of others. We are to love and to live holy lives. That's how we live out love. That's the love story of Jesus. We're supposed to live the change he made. We're supposed to give the change he made. We're supposed to be the change he made. We're supposed to be Jesus with skin on, as many people have said it. But the fact of the matter is, holiness is more about what we do than what we don't do. And many of us focus on what we don't do. And we stay huddled up, not doing stuff, and thinking that means holiness. Holiness is not just staying away from stuff. Holiness is more what you do with what Jesus gave you. What we don't do is important. But what we do is more important in this world and to those that we are called to love. The love story of the Bible, it's not that God saved and rescued his people from evil work. See, that's what we think about a lot of times. In fact, I want you to think about this. How many times have you heard people explain Christianity or getting saved or things like that by saying, well, that means I don't do this and I quit doing that and I no longer chase them, and right? And so we need to understand something. The love story of the Bible is not that God saved and rescued his people from this evil work. No, the love story of the Bible is that God saved and redeemed us. He rescued his people for a good work. Not just of being loved by him and loving him, but loving others. Are you making sense out of this? Him loving others through us as we love them, and let his love for them flow through us to them and see others come to be rescued by him. See, this is how we live love. This is the mission. We aren't rescued to just sit and wait for heaven. We aren't rescued to just come to church and shout hallelujah and get Holy Ghost goosebumps and get empowered and filled with the Spirit of God to go do nothing. And I'm sad and sorry to say this, and I love church and powerful Pentecostal service as much as the next person, but way too many times, way too many believers for way too many years have equated a powerful move of God in service as the purpose of the Holy Spirit. But that's not what the Word of God says. You can say amen or oh me right there. We aren't rescued to sit and wait for heaven. We are rescued to be rescuers. Now I want to give you one more illustration here before I close. Thomas, the doubting apostle. You guys know him, right? I want you to stay with this and follow this. He was able to see the marks of Jesus, and he believed. Jesus said to him, blessed are those who believe and have not seen. And aren't you glad that he said that? Because that's talking about us. But the truth of the fact is, many of us needed to see before we believed. We didn't just trust. We didn't just believe. We had to see. And so God showed us his marks. How did we see his marks? Thomas was able to touch him. Thomas was able to put his finger here, to put his hand here, and lay his eyes on the visible marks of Jesus. But don't you know that many of people right now would love to see, maybe need to see? They are trapped in doubt and disbelief, and they need to see the marks of Jesus because they're blinded by this unbelieving, lying, deceiving devil, and he's keeping them from truth. And they need to see the marks of Jesus. They want to believe so bad. You got to understand that Thomas wanted to believe, but he just couldn't wrap his brain around it. And there are a lot of people who say, I desperately need a change. I desperately want a change. I need to believe. I want to believe, but I got to see something. I got to see the marks. I can't wrap my brain around this thing you're saying. Can you show me something? And you say, well, Pastor, what does that even mean? I can't show them Jesus. But you can. How can they believe? How can they see? Listen to me. Jesus gave to Thomas what he needed most to believe. So what we as believers and as the church must do is to give them what they need most. And sometimes that's not, I'll pray for you, brother. Or let me tell you about sin. Let me tell you about forgiveness. Let me tell you about heaven. Sometimes it's a bowl of soup. Sometimes it's a coat on their back. Sometimes it's a hug and a tear. Sometimes it's a set of clothes. Sometimes it's standing up for the justice that they are facing and need so desperately in our lives. Sometimes it's going the extra mile to do the extra thing and putting yourself out and putting yourself second. And it's also letting them understand that God loves them as they are before they're saved. You following me? This is the love story. This is the word. This is the power. We show them the marks of Jesus. And when that is teamed up with the love and conviction of the Holy Spirit, the drawing begins and people believe. That's the call to action. That's the mission of this call. Let them see Jesus. Let them see him in us. Let this love story of amazing magnitude, this thing that started because of exile, that had a blood sacrifice involved, and yes, it was the resurrection and the crucifixion, or the crucifixion as a resurrection, but it's not just so we can be saved. That's why I told you, separate this from salvation, because when we only equate it to salvation, we stop the story right there. But listen, you need to understand something. You need to get this. He loves us. We love. We are loved. And then we love him. And then we love. And they are loved. Because they desperately need love. And then they love him. You see how this works. I want to tell you something. When God called me to move out of the ministry position I was holding to become a senior pastor, I never wanted to be a pastor. I truthfully never wanted to be a preacher. But the Lord called me and anointed me. And I always feel inadequate. Now I listen to preaching and I study. And I listen to good preaching, and then I listen to mine sometimes, and I think that's pretty good preaching sometimes. I'm confident in my call. I'm confident in who Jesus has called me to be. And I'm embarrassed of the Word of God. And I know He'll empower me and equip me for anything. So I'll walk on any stage at any time, and I'll preach the gospel to anybody, no matter how big the crowd or who's sitting in it. I'm not trying to impress people. I just want to preach the Word of God. Now, I'm not trying to pat myself on the back here. I got a point for this, and I want you to understand something. But I decided a long time ago, you know what God really gave me most of all when I was a youth pastor, when I was at the home for children, when I was working in associate work, when I was just a policeman who was saved, doing his job, and just loving his family. And before I ever studied or cracked a book or preached a message, God gave me a love for people who were just like me, who were lost and hurt and thought they could do it all by themselves and thought they had all the answers. But we didn't know what we were talking about. I was lost and on my way to hell at a neck-break speed. God used somebody, my daddy, to break into my life and save my soul. And so I decided a long time ago, when God called me to do this, listen to what I'm saying, because this applies to your life no matter who you are or what your calling is. People can go somewhere and find a better preacher. They'll find better pastors than me and Lori. And I'm proud of what we do, especially her, I'm telling you. They'll find people who are more organized. They'll find people who are more creative. You can find people who are more anointed and better orators or write books or sing songs and all these things. But I tell you this, you're going to have to go probably to heaven itself before you will find somebody who will love you more than we do. And again, I'm not pinning roses. I just know what we pray. And I know what we cry out for. And I know what God put in our heart. And I know what we determined a long time ago. I decided I could be an adequate preacher and an adequate leader and an adequate administrator. And if I could love people and submit myself to the purpose and will of God, I would be an outstanding pastor. And that's what I decided to do. Love people. You need to quit trying to be everything you think you're supposed to be, and just let people see the Jesus in you. He will empower you. He will anoint you. He will promote you. He will call you. He will raise you up. He'll make the way. He'll open the door. He'll do everything that's needed to be done. You need to quit trying to be the Holy Ghost. You need to quit trying to be the judge. You didn't make the sacrifice. Just live the life He called you to live. Be the change He made you to be. Let them see Jesus in you. That's our heart's cry. That's the love story. Now, would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Father, I just praise you today. And I love you, God. You know, I've come to a place in this walk, Lord, that I can honestly say that I love you not because of what you've done for me, but I love you because I love you. Because you love me. And I am so grateful for your love. Oh God, I love you. I pray that those who are hearing my voice right now, God, who desperately need to know your love, that you would break into their hearts, intervene into their lives right now. Show them the love. Show them how you've been loving on them. Show them the people. Show them the things. Show them the stuff. Show them your arm. Open up their eyes. Take the scales off, God. And as you did, the prophet's servant, pull back the annals of time and the clouds that hide heaven and let them see behind the scenes and realize it's been you all the time. How much you love them. Oh, how you love. God, for the rest of us,
Help us to hide behind your cross, to hide behind you, that they would see you in us. Lord, not that we would just hide behind you, but that you in us would be so strong that we just fade and disappear into you. And God, if there's one person here today who is needing that love in their life and they're not knowing you as Savior today, let them realize that you love them so much that you gave them Jesus. And he gave himself and died for them and took the sin and punishment that was theirs. And they can live in this same freedom that I've been talking about today. All they have to do is cry out, "I believe, Lord, save me. I turn to you." Do it, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, hit that link and reach out to us. I got a good friend, J.J. Weeks, who God let co-write and sing an amazing, amazing song. And I reached out to him this week and said, "Hey, I feel like God wants us to use that song at the end of this service." And he said, "Go right ahead." So we're going to play that song for you as we close this service today. And I want your words of this song. Man, it's beautifully sung. But more than that, it's beautifully said. Let these words be your heart's cry. Let these words be your anthem as you live out this love story. God bless you.
And all the songs you let me write.